All right, welcome everybody. All right, we're on. Welcome to our Anytime viewers. Welcome everybody who joined us today. And again, we'd like to thank Mr. and Mrs. Gabay for hosting us with this wonderful, amazing setup that you have prepared. So thank you very, 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 very much. Now, last week we spoke about pride, and this week we're going to speak about self-esteem. So this gets very confused with people, and there's like three parts of it that people don't understand. There's pride, there's self-esteem, and then there is humility. And how does all of that? We know humility is good. We know that pride is bad. We know that self-esteem is also good, but where does that lie? If self-esteem is good, then isn't that also pride? And what is going to be the difference of pride? So, Bezrat Hashem, the way that we're planning on doing it, this is going to be a two-part class. The first part, which we're going to focus today, is going to be on the importance of self-esteem. And the second part, which Bezrat Hashem will be next week, will be how do you tell if you have a low self-esteem? What are signs and symptoms if you can't say that people suffer from low self-esteem? And then practical applications on how to build your self-esteem. So that's going to be, the next class is going to be a little bit more practical. This is going to be a little bit more theoretical. Both equally, obviously, important. So now, to begin with, we have to explain what is the difference between arrogance, pride, and self-esteem. So I want to give you five definitions, differences. Number one, self-esteem is confidence in one's own ability. That you understand that you have the power to do certain things, and you know that you have the power to do certain things. Pride or arrogance is the fact that you feel more important than somebody else. So the difference over here lies is where you project yourself. So if you have self-esteem and that's all you have, then you're fine and content with yourself. You know that you have the ability to accomplish certain things. As opposed to arrogance and pride, where you know, regardless of whether you feel good about yourself or not, it doesn't matter. It's what you project about other people. And basically you feel that you're better, you're more important than other people. That's one definition. One difference. Number two is arrogant people that have a pride, they look down at other people. They think that they're better than other people. People with high self-esteem, they don't look down on other people. Rather, they respect other people. And they don't have the desire to bring other people down because they don't feel that threat. And this would lead us to number three. Number three, people that are arrogant, actually, you know, what they try to do is they bring other people down. How do they bring themselves up? By pushing other people down. Somebody with self-confidence, somebody who has high self-esteem, they don't need to push anybody down because they know on their own self that they are able, they have the strength and the abilities and whatever the self-esteem in that particular area that they're dealing with. That's number three. Number four is relationship. People that are arrogant have very, very difficult relationships. It's a concept they have a very hard time finding their weaknesses. They can't even admit their weaknesses. And this is what we spoke about really last week in Lent about that people that have pride have a very hard time changing because they can't admit their failures. As opposed to somebody who's confident, somebody who has a high self-esteem, he is somebody who's not vulnerable. She's not vulnerable to know that she did something wrong or he did something wrong. They're well aware that we're human and they even could be well aware of their mistakes and they know that they have to grow and whatever change in whatever aspect that they have. And the last difference that I'm going to present is eye contact. If you ever realize, if you speak to somebody who's arrogant, and let's say you're in a social gathering, they're always looking around the room to see who they could speak to that's more important than you. And it might not be like a conscious thing. It'd be like, okay, I'm speaking to loser category number three. Let's see if I could get somewhere, you know. It might just be in a subconscious way that they're just like looking around and be like, oh, this guy's cool. Let me go speak to this person. And so they'll always avoid eye contact because they're always looking who else they're going to speak to that's more important than you or more important than they feel that they need to speak to on their level. And as opposed to self-esteem, so if somebody has high self-esteem, they'll have eye contact with you. They don't care about, you know, what's going on around them. They don't care if there's somebody more important over there that even wants to speak to them. If they're speaking to you right now, they're okay.
Do you think maybe it's a cultural thing as well?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for Asians, they don't look in each other's eyes. I know Asians, not respectful.
People from our community also, actually. That's what
that's usually from a man to a woman, but woman to woman, I don't think it's like that.
I was speaking to someone, and they told me that they feel that Israelis give more eye contact than Americans.
Don't?
Yeah.
First of all, Israelis have a lot higher self-esteem. You know Israelis, I've worked with Israelis before. They're like, I tell you what to do, you know, and they walk into your store or your business and they'll be like, no, this is what's happening, you know, and that's how they bargain. You ever go to Israeli Shuk? The guy's like, imagine that the scenario in Israeli Shuk is a guy says a price and the Israeli says, no, this is the price. And the guy says, no, this is the price. And they say, no, this is the price. And then they go back and forth. Finally, the guy says, okay, forget it, I'm leaving. No, come back.
Okay.
But
he's still gonna get it. He's
an expensive store. I'm like, I got that from here, $20.
And then you come over here with that mentality. That doesn't fly over here. You come over here. If somebody's in Israel for like 2 years, you come over here. You know, okay, so let's negotiate right over here. I'm like, no, this is the set price. It's $9.99. It says so right over there. You can't negotiate. I'll give you $89.99. Be like, no, it's $99.99. People don't understand. Israelis have a lot of self-confidence. They have a lot of, so could be that could be a reason why they do that. But I know, for example, the Asian culture, they look down. Like Chinese, I don't know, Japanese. It's disrespectful to look somebody in the eye. But generally speaking, and we're not speaking about to the Asian population. And if we are, it's very minimal. And generally, when you speak to somebody, you give eye contact. Specifically, when we're talking about gender, same gender to gender situation, and especially if it's your spouse or you're dating somebody that possibly can be your spouse. Okay, so the importance of what people have to think of self-esteem as like your immune system. If you have a good immune system, then you can get sick, less likely that you would get sick, but even if you do get sick, you'll be able to go back to your healthy self very, very quickly. But if you have a very sick immune system and it's not so at full capacity, then you can get sick much easier, and your extended period of sickness usually lasts a lot longer. Somebody with a high self-esteem has the ability to, if they get down or depressed or sad at certain times, it will be a lot harder for them to get sad and depressed because they have a high self-esteem, so it's gonna take a lot to bring them down. But even when it does bring them down, they'll be able to get back up right away. So self-esteem is a very, very important concept. And it's an important concept in your psychosocial life. That's actually important in everything. It's not only that, because it could actually affect your happiness and your mood. And that it affects your physical ability. When we spoke about happiness, that somebody who's in a bad mood, somebody who's in a depressed mood, they get sick a lot faster. Why do you think people that are depressed and they're sad, they're always in bed, they're always very tired, they don't have any energy, and their body works on a slower rate. So hence it actually, the self-esteem could actually affect your physical ability to and physical well-being. Besides the physical, it also affects your emotional well-being. And we spoke about this earlier also, that somebody with a high self-esteem has a better relationship. Their relationship lasts longer, they are healthier relationships, they're not abusive relationships, and like we spoke about last class regarding the pride, how pride can be a very abusive relationship.
Is that always the case, though?
So we have to be careful over here, and I have to be careful. When I'm presenting this, I'm going to say a lot of things. And a lot of these things doesn't have to mean automatically that. It's just a high likely of a chance that this is the reason it is. And we're going to go through a lot of different ideas that it doesn't mean that someone who has a high self-esteem or low self-esteem is suffering from this malignancy or whatever it is. It's just very likely, and it's one of the causes that brings it up to it. And you'll understand what I'm saying as we go on. So if whoever here learned psychology, there is a very famous psychologist by his name of Dr. Abraham Maslow, right? Now, he had a hierarchy of needs. Now, self-esteem was up in the high, it made it into the top, whatever, five, right? I think the first one is food, then it's shelter, then it's interpersonal relationship, and then it's self-esteem. So self-esteem is like really, really important. It's like really, really up in there. And, it's something that definitely needs to be spoken about, and definitely in our generation. In our generation, I think people are suffering extremely, extremely low self-esteem. And Bezat Hashem, over this class and the next class, you'll soon understand why. When we'll break down the reason, we'll get to the root of the problem, hopefully, Bezat Hashem. Now, if you want to be happy and accomplished in your life, you have to have a high self-esteem. If you don't have a high self-esteem, even if you accomplish a lot, you won't feel happy with yourself. You won't feel successful. You'll just feel down, and you feel that you never did enough. Which, granted, is not a bad thing to think that you never did enough, because then it'll always build you to do more. But at the same time, you can't allow it to go in your negative way and not to realize your accomplishments that you actually had and went through. And it says actually in the Ali Shar that Rabbi Wolbe brings down, and he says that people that suffer a low self-esteem have to be very careful on working on humility. Because even though it's a fine line between humility and self-esteem, and obviously pride and self-esteem, but somebody who has very, very low self-esteem, if he starts working on humility, they're just going to bring themselves even lower down, and they're going to destroy the little joy that he has left, or she has left, is going to be suffered. So a person has to be careful, a person has to know themselves, even though humility is one of the most important traits that a person needs to have, you also have to know where you're holding, and how you, and if you are working on it, how are you dealing with it?
Who said that?
Ali Sharab, Shlomo Wolbe.
Is there an English book like that?
Ali Shari, I don't think they have an, they really should. But there are a lot of rabbis actually that go over the entire book, like in that. Like there's like 200 series lectures.
Wait, so you're saying that if someone has low self-esteem, they should be careful to not have humility?
No, when they're working on humility, everybody needs to have humility. But if you're going and you're actively working on humility, you're like reading all the Musa Svarim, and you're going and you're trying to make yourself more humble, and you should, you have to be very careful for someone who suffers from really low self-esteem. Because that might just shut them down and get them into more depressed. Because if you realize the way how it works with humility is when you read all this Svarim about humility, it's like you're nothing, you're this, and you'd be like, oh, I know I'm nothing, I don't know this, forget it, why get up in the morning? You know, so you're going to get the wrong angle of it. So you have to know how to angle it the right way. You should continue doing it if you're able to. And that everybody has to know their own ability. So now, there is, instead of quoting, I'm just going to tell you, where I got all this information from. Besides, obviously, the Torah. The Torah is the number one source of all information. And in fact, any psychiatry, doesn't matter, everything's in the Torah. But besides going to the Torah, I got a lot of information from Dr. and Rabbi Avraham Tversky, which is a very famous psychologist or psychiatrist, I'm not sure. I believe he went to medical school. So, and then also I got a lot of information from somebody by the name of Dr. Lieberman. Dr. Lieberman is also a famed author and a psychologist, and also from Rabbi Noach Weinberg. So instead of just quoting every single time, just note this is one of the, besides the Torah, those are the three main sources that do a lot of things that we're going to be going on. Obviously, I also went to secular sources, like we spoke about Maslow, things that, as we usually do to try to plug in everything together with the current science that we have going on. Okay. So now, this is why I reminded, because this is what Dr. Lieberman brings down. He says you have three drives. You have your soul, you have your body, and you have your ego. Your soul always wants to do good. Your body always wants to do what feels good. Your ego wants to do what makes you look good. You understand the difference between them? And that was very clear. So your body is like, you'll indulge in certain pleasures and things that just make you feel good. Forget about what everything else is. The ego is going to make you want to do something that makes you look good. Even if it's uncomfortable for you, even if it's something you don't want to do, you'll do it just to look good. And your actual soul just wants to do what's good. They just want to do what God told them to do. You want to do what's right in your mind, what's ethically and morally correct.
In conflict.
Always in conflict, yeah. So he says, he also explains, he says that what happens is when we indulge in this, instant gratification that we just want to have our desires met and all our things met, we actually create a void within us. And when we create this void within us, the way that we fill it is usually by things that we disguise as pleasure. So it could be excessive eating, alcohol, drugs, or meaningless other relationships, or whatever it is that could be that we're trying to fill that void. Now, if you ask somebody to, what they do to relax, so they'll say, read a book, I'll go for a hike, I'll go for a bike ride, I'll play golf, whatever it is, they'll say different things that they do. What they don't realize is that what they're really telling you is something called diversion. They're not, what's relaxing? Relaxing is you do nothing to relax, right? But when they're telling you is they're telling you diversion. Diversion means is that I'm escaping, which is not a bad thing. I'm escaping from reality because I'm getting my mind off. I'm playing bowling, whatever it is that I like doing. I'm going golfing. I'm going cruising on my yacht. Whatever it is that you're doing, you're taking your mind off something. You're diverting it, and in essence, you're coming to the same result, which you are relaxing because you're forgetting about your problems. But know that you're not actually doing an active act of relaxing. You're doing an active act of diversion. So you're forgetting about your problems, and that's the way it's coming to relaxing. So when you speak about, let's say somebody who has we're having nutritionists today.
No
nutritionist. So let's speak a little bit about nutrition. Binge eating disorder, right? Okay. So you have somebody that has they binge eat, right? Where does that come from? Where does this stem? A lot of these issues. So first of all, let's explain what it is. It's somebody who just can't stop eating, right? And everybody has to understand what happens is when you go to Google, you go to WebMD, everyone diagnoses themselves with whatever they read. I have this issue, I have this issue, I have this issue. You have to be careful. Just because you like eating doesn't mean you have this disorder, all right? It's but binge eating disorder is when they can't control it. They have to always eat. And they eat even when they're full. And not only that, they'll hide food. They'll save it for later, and when no one's looking, they're going to eat more. And they have this, it's a disease. And you could also tell by it is that when they're around other people, they eat very little, like a spoonful of sugar, that's it, and they're good. But when the door is shut down, they're like, raw, like Cookie Monster, taking everything down. And so this is one of the things that binge eating, and even when they actually binge eat, they feel numb. They don't gain, there's no feeling of satisfaction. Be like, oh, no, that was a good 17 steaks or 17 slices of pizza. It's like you're feeling numb, you feel guilty, you feel depressed, you feel like you just like, what did I do? And what is one of the causes of these things? Ta-da, low self-esteem. Low self-esteem is one of the causes of binge eating. Besides the fact that you have also the bulimic, so they, you know, they throw it out, you know, whatever. It's a whole life cycle. But these, all these things, this binge eating, these are diversions. You're diverting your issues. You're diverting. The real problem is the self-esteem. Real problem is not like you like food so much. The real problem is you have low self-esteem and you're overcompensating or you're undercut, whatever it is, by different aspects of it. So but the problem is, why do people do diversion? Why can't you just go and relax? And the problem is that when they're going and relaxing, they're by themselves, they don't really like the person that they're with. And that is, i.e., themselves. They don't like themselves. And they don't like themselves, so they have to divert, they have to relax by doing other things so they can't think about it. You ever realize that somebody's walking, taking a walk around the park? How many people take a walk around the park without listening to any music, just walking and just thinking, right? Thinking about yourself, people can't handle that. Some people can't handle it. Why? Because I don't like me. You know, let me listen to whatever somebody else is, something. And it's not always like that. Sometimes you just want to hear music, which is fine, whatever it is. You want to listen to shul while you're walking. By all means, it's a great thing. But some people avoid, by all means, to hang out by themselves. They get very, they don't like being by themselves. One of the reasons is because of low self-esteem.
Nice question.
Yes?
So the most effective relaxing is just doing nothing?
No. So it depends. Whatever you find relaxing. Sometimes relaxing, what's the definition of relaxing? I actually wrote the definition of relaxing somewhere over here. Is a state of being free from, this is a Merriam-Webster dictionary, right? Is she Jewish? Webster, Merriam, I don't know. Anyways, so there's probably some Hungarian Jews, like, you know what, I'm going to make a language that everyone, you know, doesn't even speak English, but like, let me teach everyone how to write. But in any case, it says the state of being free from tension and anxiety. So you can be free from tension and anxiety just by doing other things. I don't think it's a true, you know, definition of relaxation.
Right.
But instead of relaxation, it's just, you know, like, yourself will be like, oh, you know, that's it, I'm good. When you're active, you're not really, oh, I'm good. You understand what I'm saying, right? It's not like you're like, so relaxed. You can't be relaxed when you're running a marathon. It might make you relax, but it's not in a relaxing, you know, you're not relaxing at that moment. You might be relaxed afterwards, you might be relaxed, you know, you understand what I'm saying, right?
Yeah, but like, I don't get why laying down listening to music isn't a good form of relaxation.
It is in a sense of relaxation, but the way you're getting to there is through diversion. Uh-huh. It's not, you're not relaxing yourself. You're not bringing yourself to a, you know, you're sort of avoiding the problem right now. That is if you need the relax. Some people just want to listen to music for whatever reason. But if, let's say, you're having a really, really stressful day, right? So you'll go and you'll do whatever makes you relax. The actual act of relax, whatever makes you relax, is very likely going to be a diversion tactic as opposed to an actual just relaxing.
So,
and taking everything in and relaxing and putting everything in the psychological aspect of it.
What about meditation?
Meditation, I wouldn't say it's diversion. Because meditation, the real meditation is getting to know yourself. That's a good example.
So basically, what about thinking, don't they say you're supposed to think of nothing?
The beginning, that's where you're supposed to start. In order to get into your subconscious, you think about nothing. But at the end of the day, you're supposed to, what's the whole point? How long can you think about nothing for? In fact, so some of them, some meditations are a mantra. A mantra means that you're constantly repeating something again and again and again and again.
And that's not relaxation?
No, so you know that could be relaxation. That's very likely can lead to relaxation. Okay? Psychology. Everyone wants to become a psychologist. What are you majoring for in 9 out of 10 Jews? What are they going for in this? Go psychology or accounting, right? Anyways. So the next thing I want to speak about is how we reason with ourselves. I believe this was by Dr. Lieberman. I thought this was a you know, very comical and very well put. One husband one time woke up one morning and he decides he's a zombie. So, you know, apocalypse is coming, whatever he decides. He's like, he goes to his wife and says, I'm a zombie. And she's like, what are you kidding me? He's like, you're not a zombie, go to work. He's like, no, zombies don't work, I'm a zombie. He's like, and he's like, no, I, you know, and she's like, what are you kidding me? And she's like, you're not a zombie. And he's like, I'm a zombie, I know I'm a zombie. He says, you know what, I can't deal with this. He calls his mother. He says, listen, talk to your son. You know, and he thinks he's a zombie now. You know, he's crazy. Just please do me a favor. He's going to be late to work. Just talk to him. So mother gets on the phone. Mother tells him, says, you know, my dear child, you're not a zombie. And he says, listen, Ma, you know, I am a zombie. And she says, I didn't give birth to a zombie. And she says, I wasn't a zombie always. I became a zombie, silly, you know. And she's like, mother's like, listen, you know, yeah, I don't know what to tell him. So he says, so the wife says, listen, this guy's stuck all day. She calls a shrink right away. All right, speed dial, shrink, you know, and she gets an appointment that day, emergency appointment. So she goes in and with the husband, the shrink sees the husband and the psychiatrist sees the husband and says, the husband, you know, so he says, what's the problem? And she says, my husband thinks he's a zombie. And the shrink goes to the husband and says, is this true? Are you a zombie? And he said, yeah, I'm a zombie. So the shrink says, okay. He says, do zombies bleed? And the husband says like, of course not. Zombies is like the living dead or whatever they're considered themselves. They're not made of any blood. Of course they don't bleed. So the shrink says, okay. He takes a little pin and he pricks his little finger, and blood comes out. And this zombie man is staring at this. He's staring at the blood that looks at, and he's like, and for 3 minutes doesn't say a word, just looking at blood oozing out of his finger in shock, complete awe. After 3 minutes, he looks up, and guess what he says? He says, I guess zombies do bleed. And there's certain people that no matter if you slap truth in their face, it doesn't matter. They're going to see the bad. They're going to see the negative. There are certain people that have a lot of good in their life, and they're very successful. It doesn't have to be only in money or in relationship. They're very successful in many other things, but they don't see that. They're only seeing the bad. And even if you tell it to them, they'll look at it and then they'll turn it to the bad.
So how do you work with them?
One thing you have to understand, and this is so important, you cannot change anybody else. Only they can change somebody else. You could go from today until tomorrow. For example,
you could help them.
You can try helping them, but if they don't want help, it's very difficult to help somebody who doesn't want any help.
True.
That's why if let's say somebody's a drug addict, you force somebody to go to rehab. You know, they might go and they might get clean, but they're not going to be staying clean for a long time. They're just because they're not interested in it. If somebody wants help, somebody wants to change, they're going to be able to change. If you don't want to change, if you don't want any help, you could go to the best doctors, to the best shrinks, to the best psychologist. Let's say what's a good example is depression. There are people that wallow in their own depression, and it's not like their fault. Sometimes they're actually brought in due to chemical imbalances or whatever situations that they have going in life. But they go to the best shrinks, but they don't really want to. It's like too much work. It's like, no, they're used to this. They just leave me alone. This is the way it is. And the depression brings upon more depression. It's like a downward spiral. If a person wants help, they need to know that they're the only ones that can help themselves. Everybody else can assist in that help, but the main person that can change is only the person themselves. So, but granted, you can try help, because most people do want help. Even if it's a small, even if a large percentage of them be like, I just want to stay the way, there's something small that they still want any help. If you could tap into that, then you can be successful. But the point is, they have to have at least something. They have to have a little want of being better. So the idea is that some people, the way that they see themselves is always bad. And it always was bad and always will be bad. And they're good for nothing. And they're not going to achieve anything in life. And no matter how much you try to help them, they're not going to see the difference. They're not going to see the difference because they're like that zombie that even if you show them that they're not a zombie, they'll just prove it. That no, that's the way the zombies are. So the psychologists have a very interesting, it's called the self-esteem paradox, where it's a very odd thing. The more successful a person is, the more self-conscious, the more lack of self-esteem that they have. And like, why is that? It makes absolutely no sense. So Rabbi Twersky explains that. He says, this is very simple. He says there's a Gemara in Sukkah, in page 52a, that says, whoever is greater than your friend, whoever is greater, you have a stronger Yetzer Hara. So if you're the more higher you get spiritually, whatever it is, the Satan, the evil inclination, works all that much harder to bring you down. So here it makes perfect sense. He explains this. It's not a paradox at all. He says the greater that you are, the more that the evil inclination is trying to bring you down. And by the way, the evil inclination wants to make you have a low self-esteem. Because if you have a low self-esteem, right around the corner is depression. And depression is one of the best things that the Yetzer Hara can do to you. Why? Because you wallow, you don't do anything. And even if you do mitzvot, it's not out of happiness. And one of the big things that we have to do is doing mitzvot out of happiness. So let's speak about a little bit about the benefits of self-esteem and the problems that are caused with a lack of self-esteem.
So Trump has a lot of...
We'll get to the presidential debate. So I don't want to get off topic because I will get for a really long time. But you're right. But it's not always necessarily a bad thing. So some benefits of it. If a person realizes that they're great, that they have high self-esteem, they realize their greatness, then says the Gemara in Sanhedrin, they're not going to do things that are below their dignity. If people realize that every single Jew, every single woman Jew is a bat melech, you're a daughter of a king. Every single man is a ben melech, you're a daughter, you're a son of a king. If you realize that you're a son of a king, you're not going to do things that are that are not for dignity of the son of the king or the daughter of the king. So it's very, very important to raise your self-esteem, to realize who you are and what you can accomplish and where you come from, which we're soon going to speak about, because that's going to prevent you and help you accomplishing so much more and avoiding sin as well. And it goes on the flip side as well. Somebody who considers himself inferior and low self-esteem, explains the Rambam, he's not going to be careful with his behavior. He's like, yeah, so what? I could do this. You know, who do you see in the pub or in the, you know, in the bars, you know, with the, you know, throwing beer bottles against the wall and drinking beer, you know, and having all this? The lowlifes. You know, the lowlifes are the ones that, you know, that they're the ones that are sitting there. They're becoming a ruckus. Somebody who's successful is not going to go and throw beer against the wall and spill beer over his head and go like crazy when he's, you know, a successful businessman or a successful doctor or a rabbi, whatever it is. Whatever he is, if he thinks highly of himself, he's not going to associate with that. So somebody who brings himself to a higher self-esteem is going to prevent themselves from doing certain things.
They'll just do white-collar crime,
some of them. Chas hopefully not. Hopefully not.
Isn't that bad? Isn't that bad, having like a high self-esteem?
It's no. So it's you can have it as long as you keep it under control, that you're not going to get the pride. You have to, you know, you have to get that right area where, you know. And the idea is that the self-esteem is internal. Pride is external. So somebody can have very high self-esteem and still be humble. However, somebody can't be pride and humble at the same time, because those two things it's a paradox. Self-esteem is internal. Pride is external. It's what I project to others. Okay. So... by the way, this is important to just speak about that if you think of yourself very lowly, you to make a sin is not, you know, okay, whatever, yeah, why can't I do that? You know, I'm not a rabbi, you know, I'm not the rabbi's wife, I can do whatever, it's fine, don't worry about it. So the more higher you hold yourself to a higher esteem, the less likely you're going to fall into temptation, into other things that you shouldn't be dealing with yourself. And that is why, until a few years ago, nowadays it doesn't exist anymore, but somebody who was, you know, whose father or parents were from a high esteem family, they wouldn't go into drugs or alcohol or these, because I can't, you know, I come from a family. Nowadays, it's all off the table. It doesn't matter which family you're from. You could be the king's son, you know. It doesn't matter. This world is a crazy world we're living in. So the person who wishes to elevate himself, he has to realize, or she has to realize, their self-worth. You have to realize that you're worth something. When you realize you're worth something, you'll be able to raise yourself and go upon, you know, higher and higher. And in fact, this is, you know, if somebody believes that they can't accomplish anything, they won't accomplish anything, right? It's called the self-fulfillment prophecy. If you think that you cannot do anything, if you don't believe in yourself, then you're not going to do anything. You go to school and be like, I can't go to school. I don't have a head for school. Then yeah, you really can't. You know, just drop out because you can't do it. But if you go, it doesn't matter if you're, you know, you have a hollow head. But if you go like, no, I could do this. I'm going to put my effort and put my time into it. Then guess what? You're going to be able to do it. No matter the difficulties, no matter the hardships, you will be able to do it. The only person that's blocking yourself is yourself, not anybody else. So what's the Torah's perspective of, you know, of the self, of self-esteem and how you feel yourself? So it says in Pirkei Avot, in the third chapter of Pirkei Avot, it says, Hu haya omer, chaviv adam shenivra betzelem. He would say that beloved is man because he was created in the image of God. And even if this is also based off the pasuk in Bereshit, in chapter 9, verse 6, it says, Ki betzelem elokim asat adam. God made you, a human, in the form of God. Now that in itself is a source of self-esteem. You're like, you are made in the image of God. That is already, you're like a way above everybody else because you are made in the image of God. That should be a source of self-esteem right then and there. And Rav Shneur Zalman of Ladai, the original Lubavitch Rebbe, he says that if somebody looks himself as a bad person, always as a negative in a better way, then he's going to be sad. And if he's going to be sad, he's not going to be able to serve God. You're not going to be able to serve God, especially not out of a joy. And the problem is that this is all the same cycle. Is once you go into that, then you're going to wallow in depression. And once you're in depression, you know, it goes down and down and down. Now, there's a Gemara in Shabbat, page 31a, that says that somebody, a Gentile, once went over to Shammai, and he says, "Convert me." But on one condition, teach me the entire Torah that I stand on one foot. So that, you know, Shammai went, kicked him out. Says, get out. How am I going to teach you? Get out of here. What do you mean, teach you a Torah on one foot? So then he went to Hillel. And Hillel says, okay, no problem. He says, I'll teach you Torah on one foot. And then he went on to explain to him. He says, do not do to others what you don't want done to yourself. Right? The exact translation is, what is hateful to you, do not do to your neighbor. Everything else is an explanation. Go learn it. Right? And if we figure out, just by that line, you'll be able to learn so much just from that line. Right, there's a very famous thing, Ve'ehavta l'recha kamocha, right? Ani Hashem, right? It says, you have to love your fellow neighbor like yourself. If you don't have a self-esteem and you don't love yourself, how are you going to love somebody else? If you want to love somebody else, you have to first love yourself. And now, this has to be very careful. Where the way that I'm speaking now is very, because some people that have a lot of pride, this is just going to bounce it up higher and higher. So you have to accept it the right way. The way that I'm focusing on it, and it's very important that you constantly remember in the entire topic, that does not at all have to do anything with pride. It's only self-esteem that we're talking about up here. Pride is a very, very negative concept, and that's why we started with the differences. And that is very, very important. So if you want to, you know what the Hillel said, he says, don't do unto your neighbor. You want other people to treat you respectfully. You want other people not to steal from you. You want other people to, you know, give you compliments. Whatever you want done to yourself, you do to somebody else. And whatever you don't want to do to yourself, you don't do to other people. And in fact, Rashi over there explains, says, so what about God? How does this, he says, this is the whole Torah, what is about God? And it's very simple. He says, you don't transgress God's words, just like you don't want other people to transgress your words. It works the same way. And in essence, that is the secret of the entire Torah. It's a crazy secret, because from here, you can learn all character traits. Very simple. You want to be a good person? Just act to other people the way you want to act to yourself. The problem is that when we deal with self-esteem, because with people with self-esteem, they don't feel that they deserve that other people should feel good about them. They don't deserve that they should, so they're lacking even beforehand. Forget about that person should not treat other people like he wants to be treated, because this person has an issue that they're lacking self-esteem. And they don't feel that they deserve to be treated a certain way. They don't feel that they earned the right to have a certain treatment. So it says, if I don't have the right, why should I treat somebody else like that? So here in essence is a big problem, is a big void in this service of God and to people. So that is, and by the way, this is also that if not only that, when we don't love ourselves, we cannot give love, and at the same time, we cannot accept love, right? And we'll speak about that soon. You know, there's certain people with low self-esteem. I'm speaking out of order, but some, you know, they don't understand why people like them, because they're like, why do you like me? It's just, you know, why are you my friend? It makes no sense. And that's why they damage relationships. Why do they damage relationships? Could be like, why do you like me? It makes no sense that you like me. Sabotaging. What did I say? Oh, okay. I thought I said something. Oh, damaging. Oh, okay. Yeah. I thought I said something completely off.
I feel like that's not so true, because personally, I don't have the high self-esteem. That's the truth. I could love other people. Like.
So first of all, you must have a high self-esteem. Yeah. And number two. You must have, because if you like other people, that means you're able to do that. But again, it's not. First of all, let me give you a secret. This is a very easy secret. Every girl thinks they have low self-esteem.
No.
Am I wrong?
Maybe I built on it. No, you're wrong.
So it's everyone, and I'll explain. There's a very, very simple explanation why.
You just said that in front of other people, so they.
It's already, you know, yeah.
Really?
Yeah. No, but everybody has something.
Which
we're going to explain why. There's a very easy explanation why nowadays we're lacking it. Well, it's hopefully you get it. But everybody's lacking something in the self-esteem, but doesn't mean that there is lacking and then there's suffering. If you know what I'm saying, there's like severe low self-esteem, and then there is, you know, yeah, you could boost your self-esteem. Mm-hmm. So it's very likely everybody could boost their self-esteem. The problem is when people are lacking self-esteem, when they have nothing and they're so low and down in the dumps. So and, you know, and even though I say all women, men have a less of a, you know, hard time with self-esteem, but I think it more translates into pride. So, you know, and the truth is that when you have pride and when you show off pride, you're really showing a lack of self-esteem. So in essence, we'll soon explain about all this in more detail. In real essence, we're all lacking self-esteem, and we could all, you know, improve about it, and it could all, you know, help us tremendously.
There's some people who are very arrogant, so they have too high.
No, we're going to soon explain the difference. Even though we're arrogant, no, let me. Right back to Trump. So some people who are arrogant are actually showing a lack of self-esteem, and we're going to explain that shortly. So some of the benefits. Oh no, what are we talking about? Faults. Where are we? I don't know where we are. Okay. If you realize the some of the faults, and it's the reason why I tried and I worked very hard to try to get this class right after the class we did about pride, because they're very connected. And you're going to realize that things are shared. People that have low self-esteem and they have arrogance. Oh, look at that. We're sort of like right where your question is. That they share very, very common ground. People that have pride and low self-esteem. Number one is somebody who has a low self-esteem is very sensitive to criticism. They feel very, very, it hurts them a lot when somebody criticizes them, and they cannot handle criticism. Somebody with a, yeah.
But what if you, for me, like, if it's somebody that I'm very close with and they may give me criticism, like, it might affect me more than somebody that's not, I'm not so close with.
Yeah.
If it was my sibling, I would take it seriously and I wouldn't be too happy about it. But if it was someone that I'm not so close with, I wouldn't.
You don't care because you don't care what they say. Not because you don't, but the reason that it bothers you is because you take it more seriously, because it internalizes. They know me, and if this is a problem, so then it really, there's really something wrong. Some guy off the street say, hey, you know, walk in a straight line. You're like, oh, whatever, you know, I walk in a straight line, you know, when I don't drink. Well, you know, whatever, no, I'm just in the hospital, not you. I'm saying, it's good, not on the camera. But no, but you're right. There's and it, by the way, it's always like that. That's why when a spouse criticizes, when a spouse does something, it takes it into a lot more effect than when somebody else does it. And because that's even more, because you expect the most from them. And when they don't deliver, or when they over-deliver, or when they under-deliver, it bothers you a lot more. That's why when, and people are very mistaken with this concept, is like, you're nice to everybody, but when you come home, you know? Which granted is a problem, but sometimes it's easy to be nice to other people because you don't have much of a relationship with them. But when you come home, there's a very high expectancy. And when there's a high expectancy, there's a very, very easy chance of failure. Because you one wrong slip and you're done. So,
I also heard that your spouse is a mirror of you, so they're supposed to show you your problem.
Yeah. We're gonna speak about that in the one of the things to gain your self-esteem back is actually about that.
I'm trying to learn a lesson applying to my life. I can't think of something right now.
That's good. That's a good Baruch Hashem. Okay, so number one, so we said is sensitivity to criticism. They become very, very upset, people with low self-esteem, when you point out their faults. And they rather conceal their shortcomings instead of working about it. They like to like hide it, you know, the healthy way. Hide it, dig it down deep, the American way, right? And basically wait till you sleep over it. Number two, by the way, that's not healthy. That was a joke, sarcasm. Okay. So number two is they're very hypercritical, which means is that they have a need to criticize everybody. You know, somebody with a low self-esteem, they constantly go and they criticize other people. And in a sense, it sort of boosts their self-esteem. And if you realize both these things that we said, we also said about pride. And if we didn't, we should have. So number three is they also have a tendency towards blaming other people. So they made something wrong, they'll blame it at somebody else. Again, it's a fender bender, you stop short, even though that was a parked car. Whatever it is, they'll find a way to blame other people. Why would they find a way to? Because they can't handle the blame. They have such a low self-esteem that they push it off to somebody else. Number four is, and this is not always, because it could go the other way also, is they have a tendency to be shy. Low self-esteem, they can't be the life of the party, they can't, you know, be loud, they can't talk, they feel very quiet, very shy, and very, very vulnerable for that matter. But it could also go the flip side. It could also go the opposite. It'll be the overcompensate by being extremely loud. And number five is that they will always need compliments. And the example, the analogy that I found over here is beautiful, is if you take a cup and there is a hole in the cup, as long as you're constantly filling up the cup, it's going to look full. But the second that you stop filling up the cup, it's going to drain out and it's going to be empty. Somebody with a low self-esteem, they constantly need compliments. Why? Because their low self-esteem, the compliments goes and it just bleeds right out. Somebody with a high self-esteem, they take the compliment and it's been held in there. And they can last on one compliment a lot longer than other people that need constant compliments and they constantly need to fill up their cup of self-esteem. So the for this, you know, and this is what we spoke about also, another problem is that they push people away. People that love them and people that want to, you know, go after them is that they push the people away. And they think that, you know, and there's a lot of times this could be either from a girl perspective or a guy in a dating scenario where they'll be like, you know, some guy is crazy over the girl or the girl's crazy over the guy and they really like them and they think they're amazing, but they push them away because they're like, once they really get to know me, then they're going to run away and I don't want to get hurt. And one of their, so you know what, let's just, you know, cut the chase now and deal with it now. Because other time we'll speak about this more and we'll speak about the datings and the dating series. So the last thing that I want to speak about over here in the negative things is that the dangerous part is you know, if somebody has a low self-esteem, what they don't realize is that if somebody flatters them, they'll sell themselves to the person that flatters them. This is very, very common in high school, right? In high school, you want to get with a certain clique. You'll do whatever it takes to become a part of that clique, even if that's not you. And you'll sell yourself and you'll do everything, you'll go crazy just to become that part of a certain group of friends because that you feel that's where your self-esteem really is. Someone with a strong self-esteem will be like, okay, you know, they don't want to be my friend, screw, you know, that's it.
Peer pressure.
Yeah, a lot, very related to peer pressure. So, okay, now this is we don't have a nutritionist, so we're gonna have to stop. I can't go too late, so can't overdo it. So we're gonna start with this. This is a long topic. And we'll have to continue with it. It's how we compare ourselves to others, and the source of the lacking of self-esteem in it. So number one is we're gonna wait for the experiment afterwards. What is the root of healthy self-esteem? What people mistakenly think is that it's dependent on how other people see you. And this is not self-esteem. This is an extremely bad way of going at self-esteem, is by going on somebody else's recognition. when people go and you meet them and all they speak about is, you know, they went to Harvard and now they're working in a top tier law firm. And, you know, they have all these things that may, they're like, okay, you know, I have a high self-esteem, I accomplished a lot. What they think is a high self-esteem actually comes across as arrogance. I had a friend of mine that came over with me once, and he told me he met once someone in his class growing up's mother. And, you know, she was telling him, you know, she's like, you know, it's like, oh, are you this boy's mother that, you know, she's like, oh, yes. Like, oh, you know, I went to class with him. I went to, you know, we went to class together. And she's like, oh, very nice. And for the next, like, 5 minutes, she lists off, like a proud mother does, you know, all his accomplishments. You know, he finished Shas. He was all the amounts. That's amazing. He was in the Columbia Law School. Well, that's beautiful. And then she ends off, you know, and he got married a few years ago. And he has 2.5 kids. And this is, I'm telling you, I'm not changing the thing. This is exactly how he said it. So he's like, is everything okay? Like, what was one, like, why is it 0.5? And she's like, no, I'm expecting, you know? So then, what did she go? She says, and what about you? And this guy wasn't married yet and didn't have he didn't go to Harvard. So then she put him on the spot. And I'm like, that's disgusting. That's not showing off that you have a high self-esteem. That's showing off 100% arrogance. That's 100% arrogance. And it's rooted, what people think is if they perceive me better, then I will have, in turn, a higher self-esteem. And then the answer is absolutely not. And in fact, the secret of self-esteem is actually hidden in humility. Real, genuine humility is actually the secret to self-esteem.
How would they perceive...
People think that if they show off to other people, other people will look up to them, and then they will have a high self-esteem. Because people mistakenly conceive that self-esteem is based on what other people look at you, which in essence is really arrogance and pride. So... The fact that, you know, somebody who has a high self-esteem doesn't feel the need to get constantly praised, doesn't feel the need for other people to constantly look, because they know their value. They know that they're worth it. They know it. Somebody who's arrogant feels a lot lacking, and it feels that they need to get it from other people. And this is very, very bad, and this is the entire topic that we're going to speak about for the next few minutes until we stop, is going to be about how people compare other people, and that's how they base off their self-esteem. Which is, by the way, whether you like it or not, is so common nowadays. So common. Yes.
Does low self-esteem somehow manifest in people being, let's say, like seeking chesed over too much? You know what I'm saying? Like sometimes
it depends if it's coming at the expense of something else.
People always want to do favors because they want you to make them feel good and like give you compliments. And
it can be, but I wouldn't say straight off, because some people are just those type of people that always want to do good. The way that you can really tell is how they do chesed at home. You know, they help everybody else, but do they help their wife? They help everybody else, but do they? This is a really strong balance that people have to do. People that like to do that. People, you know, this is a struggle that, you know, that I have to take, because I'm out almost every single night. So I have to, like, balance it and be like, am I doing something right or am I doing something wrong? Because I'm thinking, okay, I'm giving shiuri, I'm giving classes, it's amazing, it's great, it's what Hashem wants. But is it? Is it coming at the expense of my wife? And my wife has to be on board. And if she doesn't want me to go, then I can't go. And I won't go. Baruch Hashem, she's an amazing wife, and she lets me go. Hence, I'm here. But if, you know, but I have to also, you know, make sure that you're helping part of the house. People think, okay, I'm going to do chesed. I'm going to deliver, packages of food before Shabbat. But let's say your wife needs your help to vacuum before Shabbat. But the problem is that people play each other. Be like, okay, I can't do it because my wife needs my help. Meanwhile, you're playing video games for Shabbat while your wife is sweating and cooking and doing all these things. So you're playing one for another. You have to be careful what you do. But so the answer is that it really depends. Some people love helping other people. Those are amazing people. Get to know them.
Is it possible that also high self-esteem is also correlated with having gratitude?
Yeah. Oh, that's very interesting. I'm going to apply that into the... That is very good, actually.
Yeah,
I think I heard gratitude, if you're very thankful, it also leads to happiness because you feel like you're lucky to have...
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Gratitude is one of the things that lead to happiness. And that was one of the things we spoke about when we spoke about the topic of happiness. When I gave it to the girls' class, I gave it a little bridge. The men's class was a lot longer. It was two classes. But we did speak about that, and that's 100%. You want to be happy, be grateful. The more grateful you are, the happier you will be. Okay, so speaking about comparing us to other people, you ask a 3-4-year-old child, be like, hey buddy, can you draw? And be like, yeah, I can draw anything. What do you want me to draw? And they're like, can you draw me a house? And they'll draw something that looks like someone had a seizure while holding a crayon. And they'll be like, look, this is the house. I'd be like, where's the door? I'd be like, it's over here, and the sun is over here, and the grass is over here. And they're completely confident this is amazing. You go to an adult, be like, can you draw? The adult will be like, no, you know, I'm not an artist. And be like, no, but so what is the difference? The child thinks that he can draw. The adult thinks that he can't. You know why? Because the adult compares himself to people who can draw. The child doesn't care. He's like, yeah, I can draw. I can do everything. Children are very confident. You know, children that come from that, they're very confident. I can do anything. Yeah, I know everything. So the and this is something you could learn a lot from children, actually. You know, for example, a child. The child has a tantrum. Right? It's like throwing, you punish him and it'll send it to the room. And you know, the child goes in the room, he's like getting really upset, he's crying there. And then like 2 minutes go by and you go into the room and you start playing with him. Yeah, you tickle him, you throw him up in the air. 2 minutes go by, he is rolling on the floor. He could even forgot about the bad thing that happened. You go to somebody else, you insult the other person, an adult, right? For 1 month, they're still like, oh, no, I'm not looking at you. Even though if you apologize. Now, what is the difference? What is the difference between a child and an adult? And the besides even self-esteem, it's a child would rather be happy than be right. An adult would rather be right than be happy. And it all boils down to, after that, to ego and self-esteem. Why? Because you did this to me. No, because what happens when the couple has a fight? They could easily fix it up, but the ego doesn't want to because they rather be right than be happy. And that is a very, very big problem in adults. It's much better to learn from children, be happy, than rather be right. Give it up, say I'm sorry, even if you didn't mess up, just apologize, whatever it is, just to make it go away. Obviously, if it's a continuous issue and it needs to be dealt with, that's fine. But if it's something stupid, just grow, you know, move on, become the happier person rather than becoming the right person. Now, we'll go for a few more minutes, is that okay?
Yay.
Okay, so the idea is, and the Michtav Meliyahu explains this, he says, the greater lack of self-esteem, the greater need for validation of one's self-worth. So the lower that a person has a self-esteem, the more that they seek other people to validate themselves for them. And this is a very big problem because, you know, people that that think that their other people are going to boost their self-esteem, which means is that they're depending on other people of their happiness. So I'm not going to be happy because self-esteem is equally related to happiness. Right? If I'm not going to be happy, I'm not going to have a high self-esteem unless somebody else validates me. And now what happens if someone doesn't validate me? My self-esteem goes down the toilet. Somebody validates me, okay, so I'm good for until the validation leaks out of that hole of the cup. But when you're being dependent on somebody else, it's a very unhealthy relationship. And why is it unhealthy? Because if they criticize you, you're crashed. If they compliment you, you're good. So your happiness is not independent of you. Somebody with a low self-esteem, his happiness is dependent on other people. And that's a very, very terrible thing. Why would you want your internal happiness dependent on somebody else? It could be your husband, your parent, your brother, your sister, your coworker, your boss, whatever it is. Don't want it to be dependent on anybody else rather than yourself. Now, the idea is also is that when we tend to depend our validation on other people, we overanalyze every single situation. So she saw me, but she didn't say anything to me. You know what that means? She for sure saw me. I saw her looking at me. She saw me, and she didn't come over to me. You know, maybe because I didn't say hi before to her, and I didn't, you know, like, so much drama. I can't handle that. You know, and they constantly, like, they're talking to themselves. They're overanalyzing it. Meanwhile, the other person may or may have not seen it. You've been looking, like, oh, look, a flower. And may have not seen it. And meanwhile, they're, like, 14 steps ahead of them, and then they woke up and be like, you know, forget it. I didn't want to be your friend. And but like, what are you talking about? I didn't see you. You know, where do you come from? And they overanalyze every situation. And it very unfortunately, it very comes in handy. It doesn't come in handy. It comes in contact a lot with in marriages. You know, because marriages, every little thing, it's like an atomic bomb. You know, especially if the marriage is a little shaky. If the marriage is solid, then okay. But if once a marriage gets a little shaky, every little thing is an atomic bomb because they overanalyze every situation. Well, he didn't say good morning when he woke up today, and he walked out of the house without saying goodbye. He must be upset about something. I wonder what I did wrong. He's like, you know what? He has a right to be upset. I have a right to be upset. You know what he did to me last night? And then he comes home, completely whistling, great mood, and be like, you know what? You know, screw you. You know, I'm mad. I'm like, what are you talking about? What did I do? I'd be like, what did you do? What did I do? You were upset first. I'd be like, what are you talking about? I'm not upset. So they overanalyze everything. And what happens at the end of the day? It's a lose-lose situation. So this is a very, very bad thing when you're dependent on other people for your self-esteem. Now, this is also why, you know, flight attendants, right? When a flight attendant come up, yeah, you know, if you fly often, it just drives you crazy. The engine's over here, the light's over here. I think you're going to have the flow thing. You're gonna go, you know, everyone like knows it by heart by this time. But what do the flight attendants say if, let's say, in the case of oxygen deprivation, you know, there's oxygen mask going to fall from miraculously from the sky, and you're going to put it first on yourself and then put it on your little child sitting down next to you. You want to know why? Is because if you don't take care of yourself, you're worthless to somebody else. And if you don't take care of your self-esteem, you're not going to be able to provide a healthy family. And you're not going to be able to provide a healthy setting for your husband and for your children, or vice versa, for your, you know, for all the men watching, for the wives and for the children. If you want to be a good source of strength, you have to make sure that you're in an okay standing of where you are. So the idea is also people understand that everybody is important. Now, what does it mean that everybody is important? People think that, you know, and this is so uncommon, you know, we'll speak a little bit about the presidential debate, but, you know, like, people feel by pushing other people down, they raise themselves up. The non-Jewish world, the secular world is 100% like this. You guys go, you know how guys joke? By pushing other people down, you know, psychologically. You know, guys work in a certain psychological way. I think women work in a lot more twisted psychological way. It's like, guys are like, straight out, you suck. A woman be like, you know, like, you're so pretty. She's so pretty. You know, like, what? I heard you. You know, like, and you know, guys work in a very, very different way. Now, but they'll push people down. Why they push people down? Because they feel, you know, that's going to raise themselves up. It's going to make them feel a little better. Now, says the Mishnah in Pirkei Avot, in the fourth chapter of Pirkei Avot, Ezehu mechubat ha-mechabed es ha-briyot. You want to know who's an honored person? Somebody who honors somebody else. You want to get the honor? Honor other people, then you'll be honored. People very mistakenly think that if I go and if I put other people down, people are going to look up to me. And it doesn't work that way. In the psychological, the Torah knows psychologically more than anybody else. And it says, if you want to have honor, if you want to be honored, honor other people. And this is something I don't understand in the presidential debate, in the presidential, you know, when they actually debate each other, it's like 10% they speak about themselves, 90% they speak about how bad the other person is. And I'm thinking about this. I'm like, this is ridiculous. I'm sitting over here. This is going to be the most powerful, one of the most powerful people in the entire world. And they're playing like fourth graders. And again, don't listen to her. She's so smelly. You know, I'll be like, oh no, this guy, he's orange, you know. And they're like, you know, they say all these things. Why? Just to push other people down. You realize that this is so immature. Like, how are we doing? And it's like, you know,
But I think the whole world realizes that.
It is, but it's a terrible way.
No, you can't watch it.
It's very terrible.
You know, so dumb, I think I can't watch it.
I think the secular world really, like, they're not fooled by it. They realize that it was a joke. The whole thing was a joke.
Yeah, it's a very interesting. This, by the way, by this election, you could just tell how God runs the whole world.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like you guys, and you know what you think about, because the entire liberal media all wanted Hillary, which by the way, should make you think, why? Something's going on here. Why would they want somebody who's so corrupt and so proven of corrupt, and they so push her for, you know, for it? There's something going on over here.
They're
why is she
corrupt?
Politicians are corrupt. Yeah, listen, money blinds you, politics blind you, honor, you know, all these things blind a person. But the question is like, okay, who is going to be less bad in the office? Like, and that's, you know, that's who you should vote for. Well, now it's too late. But who is going to be less bad? You know, and it depends. As Jews, we have to go and focus on what's going to be in Israel. How is it going to be in our institutions? Somebody who's going to love Jews. Or you're going to have the other option. You have someone who's an anti-Semite, or the vice president is anti-Semitic-ish. Can't, God forbid, say anti-Semite, because they'll be like, well, they're not anti-Semite. But the liberal people vote for something, and then the conservative people vote for a different person.
They both have a Jewish son-in-law.
Majority is by Trump.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the idea is, yeah. But only one. But yeah. But only one of them is actually Orthodox.
She doesn't do it. She is. I see her.
Oh, Ivanka.
Oh yeah.
She's Orthodox. She married Jared Kushner. Yeah. They pray in the same synagogue as my wife's uncle. Yeah, in Fifth Avenue Synagogue. Yeah. So.
Wait. So you don't have to wear mikracha.
Just because they do that doesn't mean that it's right.
Yeah,
there it's something called modern Orthodox, which is not a topic now. It's a topic for soon because I am working on it. I'm working on a topic of all different sects of Orthodox, of Judaism. Well, yeah, if she, as long as she had a real, or, you know, conversion, if she had to do other, and I, from what I hear is, yeah. I think, yeah, at least so. Okay, anyways, but the idea is, here's something, the Rabbi Shalom Ber of Lubavitch explains like this. He says, One of his chassidim goes over to him once and says, Rabbi, I don't understand. How do you have respect for such low people? And this guy was coming from a wealthy family, a wealthy businessman. And he says, and his business was, he was a diamond merchant. So he says, can you do me a favor? Can you show me some diamonds? So he said, sure, he had a packet on him. He opened up the diamonds. And he was looking at the diamonds. And one diamond was a nice big diamond. And the rabbi opens up and be like, wow, this is a beautiful diamond. And the merchant would be like, you know, with all due respect, Rabbi, I mean, it's a nice diamond, but this smaller one is much more, it's clarity, it's beauty, it's, you know, the color is much better in this one than the other one. And the guy says, no, what do you mean? This one looks much nicer, much more shiny. And he says, no, no, he says, for you, an untrained eye, it looks better. But for me, a specialist, that this is what I deal with, I could tell where the diamond is worth more and where it's, you know, really just a show. And an inside has a lot of blemishes. So the rabbi smiled and he says, I, just like you're a specialist in diamonds, I'm a specialist in souls. And I'm able to see special souls. And every single Jew is a special soul. And that's why I honor every single Jew, because every single Jew is special. Every single person is special. So now there is, what happens is it's very dangerous when people start basing their self-esteem, basing their confidence, when they compare themselves to other people. So what happens is when you compare yourself to other people, okay, but look at this, you know, person, you know, and they're married already, they have three kids, you know, they have a house, and they have this, and they have this, and they have this, and I don't have any of this. And you start feeling bad about yourself, and you start feeling, you know, your confidence, your self-esteem is all going down. And your self-esteem should not be at any sort of which way compared to somebody else. He says, first of all, even if you would, imagine somebody would be, you know, and a lot of people would be like that, be like, oh, I wish I could be that person. That person has a great life. And then when you find out a lot about that person's life, they'll be like, no, you know, I wouldn't change it. And let's say you would have the option. Say, okay, listen, you have all your problems in your life, all your pros, all your cons, and you have an option. You could take somebody else's life. And when you say, okay, I want that person's life. And you go and you look into that and be like, wow, you know, okay, this person has whatever they have going for them, but then they have psychological issues, and then they have health issues, and then, you know, the problems with the family, and be like, you know what, with all due respect, my problems are worth, I'll stick with my problems. And in fact, most of the people that you'll do that, you think you have better lives than you, when you actually look into it, and you can't really, because everybody knows only themselves, when you actually look into it, say you would be able to, you'll be realizing, no, thank you very much, no thank you. I'd rather deal with my issues, with my problems, than deal with somebody else's. And this is a big problem with, you know, especially in the men area when it deals with financial issues or money issues. When they look at other people, they'll be like, okay, you know, this guy already bought a building in Manhattan. He says, look at this, you know, and he's only whatever. And people are like, you know what, and they're basing it off, and people don't understand that, you know, it's very likely that, yeah, imagine this person bought a building in Manhattan, and then shortly afterwards they get arrested. And shortly afterwards the whole family, even if they're not guilty, it'd still be like, you know what, not worth it. You know, I knew somebody that was very successful financially, and everyone's like, wow, look at this guy. And then, and now he's sitting in prison for a few years for whatever issues, you know? So everybody was like, wow, look at this guy, he's doing so successful. At the end of the day, you look at it and be like, you know what, I wouldn't change it. And in fact, I asked this to a guy class once, and I said, let's say you'd be able to, sit in prison for 3 years, you get $5 billion. Most normal people would not do that. Especially if they're married, they have a kid. No, I'm not going to sit in prison for 5-10 years that you could give me a few million dollars. I'd rather not. You know, because there's some. So people don't realize is that they look always at the negative aspect. Look at the positive aspect, because you'll gain a lot more by looking at the positive than looking at the negative. Now, this is a big problem with social media. We always have to come back to social media. Social media, with the way people do is that there are people that just stalk till midnight or midnight, midday or from midnight to midday. You know, all day just like scrolling through other people's profiles and judging other people and then comparing themselves to the other people. So they're looking, okay, look, wow, she went to Aruba this year, she went to Cancun, and she went to Israel, and she went to, you know, and then yada, yada, yada. You know, and I only went to Puerto Rico. You know, and then you're like thinking and be like, you know what, look at her, this person's living the life. And you're comparing it. Meanwhile, she could have, you know, people very systematically, they save their pictures and they post it, you know, very periodically and be like, oh, hubby just took me another vacation. Oh, really? They took me another vacation? He didn't take me on any vacations. You know, and then it comes to all issues and you start comparing yourself to other people. This is one of the main reasons that I feel that social media is a destroyer. It destroys you. It destroys you socially. It destroys you mentally. It destroys you. And then eventually it destroys you physically. It's not something that's healthy. So that problem is over here is that people, they compare themselves to other people. When you compare themselves to other people, you don't know their issues. You know why they had maybe 5 vacations? Because they're on the verge of divorce or something. You don't know. And you know what? I'm not that bad when you think about that. This is why some people have and I speak about this often, that magazine that people buy that are constantly, what they're doing is that they lie about celebrities. Why do people buy that magazine? Because they compare themselves to the celebrity is worth $250 million, you know, and she's glamorous and whatever, but she's going through a crazy divorce and her husband has a drug addict and their child, whatever. And you're like, okay, I feel a little better, you know? Why? Why does it make you feel better? You should not compare anybody else to you. You are you and they are they, and they never two shall collide. You are on two separate paths. And the way the media does it is the media sort of tricks you into making yourself feel what you should be feeling and makes you tell you what you're supposed to look like and how you're supposed to do it and how you're supposed to present yourself. And when you don't do that, you feel bad about yourself. And this is why also, he says, one of the reasons why I think women, one reason why women have such a low self-esteem now is because everything is photoshopped online. You look at it at magazines, you look at it, everything is photoshopped. And besides the Photoshop, even real life, you know, there are people that spend thousands of dollars on cosmetic, besides surgeries and makeups and all these different things to cover up any blemishes or things like, or any sort of, you know, inconsistencies. And other people look at them and be like, wow, look at them. That's amazing. You know, and this, you know, is, you know, it's a very, very big problem when you're comparing yourself to somebody who's not really existing. You're going to this Photoshop picture and be like, wow, this person's amazing. Look at them. And you're like, wow, if they're so good and I'm lacking, then you start feeling bad about yourself. So women are constantly comparing themselves to the supermodels that even in real life don't look like that. There was like a slideshow of like how certain women that are considered very pretty in Hollywood, with makeup, without makeup, with Photoshop, without Photoshop. And you look at them, and you would, you know, if they walk in the street, you'd be like, you know, yeah.
Also, there was a TED Talk, and models apparently have very low self-esteem because they see themselves being photoshopped so much.
Oh, that they don't like themselves. Oh, that's very interesting.
They think that they're pretty, but they see.
Right, they don't see, which is why a lot of them are anorexic, I believe. One of the models, I don't know which one.
Yeah.
Yeah, they have a big issue of anorexia. So, right, but there's some people that if they're only bones, then it gets dangerous, you know. Because anorexia is not being skinny. Anorexia is where you're like scary skinny, you know, like skeleton skinny.
But most of them are.
The what?
Most of them are.
But yeah, yeah, that is true. So this is you know, and this is the idea, and you know, that people look fabulous, look amazing, looks like have a great life, and who knows how many medications they could be on. And in fact, you don't know, I get calls for shidduchim for other people, for the guys and for whatever it is. So one of the questions I get so often, they always like feel nervous, it's like as if I got the first question for time. And they're like, I'm just going to be blunt with you and honest, please let me know, are they on any medication? Are they on any medication? Constantly get that question, because it's so common, unfortunately. Are they on any medication?
Psychological
medications. That when shidduch, and when people call me for the references for shidduch, one of the questions that they ask, one of very
popular.
Oh my God.
You should ask them. Yeah, you should ask them.
People will actually tell the shadchan or shadchanit, I'm on medication.
No, that's why they ask the references. If somebody is on a medication, you and somebody calls you up and be like, listen, I want to date this person, are they on any medication? You, first of all, should speak to a rabbi depending on the medication, depending on what the issue is, because there's a lot of variables coming there, but it's very likely that you have to say something.
What?
Yeah. You should.
Whenever I ask questions like this, men, people think I'm crazy.
You ask the no.
No. To the reference.
Oh, to the reference. Well, I don't. I would be shocked if you didn't ask that nowadays. But maybe because it's me, I know I deal a lot more in public than other people. So I, you know, but people don't realize how common it is. So, anyways. So this was also the problem with, you know, social media, TV, movies. You're looking at all these things and you can make yourself, you live up to something that doesn't exist. And besides the fact, and you look at it, you know, like, you know, this person's living in, you know, Hollywood and they're driving this car and they're going on this vacation and they have a great life. And meanwhile, and you're watching this movie or this TV show and you're like, wow, that person has an amazing life. And my life is so boring. Working 9 to 5 and then this and then this. And you're like, and you start comparing yourself to everything else that you see. And that is one of the biggest things that shoots shoots your self-esteem straight down the tube. And this is a big problem, I think, when nowadays you have so many issues with self-esteem, is because this is getting pushed out like no one's business. It's getting all the advertisements, all the people that are stuck on TV and movies and all these issues, they're constantly getting shoved down their throat, how they're supposed to look, how they're supposed to feel, what they're supposed to do, and then when they feel that they don't live up to that, their self-esteem goes down. And this is why I always scream about it, get rid of all these things. It doesn't help you. It doesn't help you. Granted, it's very difficult to. It is very difficult to, but the more they regret it, the happier that you will be, the less the comparing that you're going to be. I'll finish with this thought of how the media could convince you of something that you're really not, and it's very easy to do that. And let's see how it works with this experiment. So now we're gonna divide the room into half. Okay, everybody on this side and everybody on this side. I'm gonna show you a picture and I'm gonna show you a picture. And then I'm going to show you another picture. So when I show this side of picture and when I show this side of picture, don't look at the other picture. Okay, we're going to do it at the same time. And then I'm going to show you a third picture, and then I'll give you instructions afterwards. So right now I'm going to lift up two pictures. I'm going to, so pick whichever side you want to be on, because you're in the middle. Okay, so it doesn't matter. And don't look at the other person's picture. Very hard. You know what? Close your eyes all this side. Let's do it this way. Okay, ready? One, and I'm going to show just you. Okay, focus on this picture. You're focusing on it? Okay, the camera could see it also, right? Mm-hmm. You're looking at it? Okay, good? Okay, now you guys close your eyes. All right, ready? Focus on this picture. Focus on it, concentrate on it, look at all the features, get it, everything in your mind, memorize it. You got it? Camera can see it? Okay. Now, everybody open your eyes. I'm going to show you another picture, a third picture, and what I'm going to ask you, it's a picture of a woman. I want you to figure out, don't say it out loud, think, concentrate a little bit, how old around the woman would be. That's all you need to do. Just an age, roughly an age. It could even be a range. Okay, ready?
30.
Shh.
Less. Oh, we don't.
Not yet. Yeah, but we're going to say it afterwards. Good? Mm-hmm. You see it? Mm-hmm. You see it? Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, they're going to, let's pick up this side first. Don't change whatever you think. You have a number in your mind? Rough round number? Okay. You said 30. What do you guys say?
20s. But I see both. But
okay. Yeah, and what do you guys see?
25.
25 also?
40.
40? 18, even younger. Nobody sees it. 80. Oh, very good. Thank God you said that. Both Hashem. Well, yes. I showed him a different picture. This, if you realize it, this side of the room picked a higher number. This side of the room picked a lower number. Now let me show you the first pic. Let me show you this picture again. This picture is really two pictures in one. Mm-hmm. Right? If you realize it, you guys, I showed you a picture of a young girl. Mm-hmm. So you associated this with a young girl. Yeah. The nose over here, the eyes over here. This is a necklace, and this is her whatever it's called. Right? For you guys, I showed you an old woman.
Wow.
And when I showed you an old woman, so look at over here. This is the nose. This is the mouth.
Oh my God!
You know,
whoa.
This is the ears. Some people, and I'll explain why. But the idea is, Baruch Hashem, that it worked. Thank you, God, for you also, because you gave me the. Baruch Hashem. So now the idea is that I was very easily, within a few seconds, been able to show you the same thing and convince you of what you're going to see. Or more or less. For you, I showed you a young woman. And you concentrate on the young woman. You saw a young woman. For you, I showed you an older woman. So you saw somebody a little bit older or somebody significantly older and things like that. The idea is this is how the media works. The media pushes things onto you. It pushes things onto you. This is how advertisement works. How does advertisement work? They work with subconsciously. You ever realize you see an advertisement and it'll be like, you know, somebody running through a forest with a dog. And then, you know, they get spritched, a car comes by. And then they see like a monkey swinging from the trees, right? And then afterwards, you know, they'll come, you know, at the end, it'll be like, Apple. You know, the product. And be like, what would that have to do with Apple? It had nothing to do with Apple. And the answer is, the way that advertisement works is so psychologically, you know, you ever see that sometimes you'll go in an ad and it'll be just like a cherry. And you'll be like, what is that? You know, what's the ad? And it bothers you. And you start like, what's the ad? And you start, they're very psychological when they deal with that. So they'll get into your head, not by slapping the advertisement of what they want you to buy, but rather, what's a good salesman? A good salesman is not convincing you that you should buy this, but convincing you that you want to buy it, that you need to buy it. Not that it's good for you. It's like, they're like, no, I need it. Even though you're selling them something that could be nothing, but you're convincing the other person that they need it. The way that the media works, they push you how they want to do it, which is why I believe, you know, for example, Hillary Clinton, for example, right? The media pushed nonstop for her. Nonstop for her. And it pushes on what they want for you to buy. What the media is pushing nowadays, everyone has to be skinny. Everybody has to look great. Everybody has to do this. Everybody has to drive a certain car. Everybody has to do certain things. They're pushing it onto you. And when you don't live up to the expectation that you feel that you need to be, which is this young woman or whatever it is, then you lack in self-esteem. And you lack in confidence. And you lack in issues that you fall short in because you are comparing for everything else. And this is one of the terrible, terrible things that if you want to fix on it, is that you have to stop comparing it. We have to stop comparing to other people. You have to stop comparing it to the media. You have to stop comparing it to anything that you see on social media, because you are you and they are they, and then never two shall the paths combine, unless you get married. But besides that, otherwise it should stay far apart. There is more things that I need to speak about this, but being that it's late, we'll catch up on this. We'll start from here next week, and we'll hopefully be able to finish it in two, and we're going to continue with this topic as well. with this idea as well, as comparing to others, because there's a lot more that I have to speak about.
I don't know if it's included in the other class, but how do you deal with someone who's prideful or has a very high ego?
You and somebody else has the problem, it's very hard. The idea is they have to fix it.
No, but I'm saying, like, how do you work with them? Not how do you change them, but how do you work with them? Like, how do you
help them?
Oh, how do you
help? Not how do you help them.
Oh, how do you deal with it?
How do you deal with them?
It's a very good question. And it depends on.
If you have to work with them on something, or if you need something from them, or whatever.
Right. I'll tell you a very easy secret, and that it helps with everything, is some people bring up points. Let's say, for example, you're working on a project together with them, or they're asking questions, whatever it is, and let's say you don't want to go their way. So this is an easy way. I shouldn't say manipulation, but it's a little bit of what you can easily do is you have to validate their opinion. It'll be like, yeah, you know, that's an amazing idea. We should really do that. And even though you really don't want to do it, and then be like, you know, you're and then give them a compliment after that. But just because you're wanting, this is not going to help them. It's going to help you. And you're like, you know, that's a great idea. Hey guys, listen to this great idea. And then after they get their self-worth and they get that, you'll be like, but you know what? That's a great idea, but what about this one? I think this one might, you know, you give them what they need, and what they need is their validation. Once you get that validation, you swoop around back where you need to what you need to do. Now again, is that gonna help them? Probably not. It's gonna help more you than them. In order for them to help them, they have to help them.
Yeah.
So it's an idea that has a lot to do with them and not you, but if you have to work with them, that is a very easy and a proven way that should work. Hopefully, Mizrach Hashem. Listen, the main thing is also pray. Pray for them. People that are arrogant are very hard to deal with, and you can pray for them. Pray for them that they should become better people.
Side question. So, do you think the media was paid by the Clintons? Like, why did
I don't know? No, I don't
by
think
the way,
because financially, probably.
Yeah.
It could. First of all, it could really be that they really like her policies. It's very possible. B. It's very possible that it's better for them financially.
The polls that they gave didn't even correspond to the election results.
Well, they wanted.
Well, they changed it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's obviously something going on over there. There's obviously, I don't know what that is. It's very possible that they financially get better tax cuts with her. You know, it's very, you know, because again, she got a lot of donations from, you know, very wealthy people. So, you know, it makes sense why they'll push it. But again, who knows? You know, we can only, you know, speculate. But at the end of the day, it doesn't matter. At the end of the day, you should realize that if it was Trump, it was Hillary, it doesn't matter. It's all from God. At the end of the day, it's all from God. It makes no difference. What we have to do is we have to go to Ishtadlut, and we have to figure out who is going to be for us better and vote for that person. And once you did that, the rest is up to God. It doesn't matter. You know, it's good. It's not. Baruch Hashem, hopefully. Listen, hopefully it will be very good for Israel. It's going to be good for the Jewish people and good for the general population as well. Any other questions? No? All right. Chazak u baruch.